some tough sayings in the book from Jesus about our ability to follow and to serve both the world and God. And Paul writes in Galatians, "For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit to the yoke of slavery." Why do you think he would say this to the Jews? Submit to the yoke of slavery? We don't think of them as slaves, do we? Paul is reminding the Jews who are under the law, remember there are 633 of them, that they are now free. Fred Craddock, a noted theologian, writes about this passage. There are three potential dangers to freedom. So I want to explore that with you today. The first one is that freedom can actually be more difficult than slavery. Does that make sense to you? Freedom can be more difficult than slavery? Because when you're free, you have new responsibilities. You're not led by the nose, or the hand, or by laws. Freedom is written on your heart, and so you are more accountable. You don't have to live under the law for the law's sake. At one point in my life, we have these times, it's like, oh God, if you could just give me an instruction manual. Has anybody ever wanted an instruction manual? I certainly have. Like, what do I do next? Yes, absolutely. Because with that instruction manual, our duties and our guidelines are well spelled out. Well, that's New Testament, guys and ladies. The irony is that freedom requires greater effort on our part. Because there's more wishy-washiness. We have to interpret more. Fred Craddock also writes that the second potential danger to freedom is that freedom may destroy community. Paul, in his letter to the Galatians, challenges them as freedom is an opportunity for self-indulgence. What I need is more important than what you need. Think about that. There's a healthy and an unhealthy continuum of freedom. Freedom where it's laissez-faire and you can do whatever you choose, no matter who it is. And then not having freedom, or an unhealthy, right, that happens. An unhealthy freedom is that laissez-faire, where you can hurt whoever you want. Whereas the healthier freedom is when you do it with intention and consciously, so that you're making choices based on not necessarily what is good for you, but what is good for all. So I ask you, as far as self-indulgence, what is your weakness? What is your temptation? Is it to the addictions or addictive behavior with food, drugs, sex, exercise, gambling? You can name it. Is your addiction or your self-indulgence to fake intimacy? What's fake intimacy anyway? When you talk so much that you don't listen. You have such a monologue going over, or you keep things going up so fast that you're not vulnerable with others. You don't listen to what they're saying. Because you're talking so much. So above all about me, myself, and I. And if your obsession is that fake intimacy, if that's your protective layer, then you need to ask yourself why. What are you afraid of? What would happen if you were quiet and didn't have all that attention on yourself? What would it require of you? The opposite of that is listening so much that you never share. And again, ask yourself why. It's a fake intimacy. Because you're really not in a give and take relationship. You're either giving everything, and maybe also officially as well, or you're just listening in your sponge, and you don't have to give anything except your attention. Is one of your self-indulgences perfectionism? I bet a lot of us fall into that category. Whether it's your effort in work, landscaping, school, or group membership, whether it's cleaning. How about obsessiveness and compulsiveness? Those are all efforts at self-indulgence to keep whatever God is saying to you at bay. It makes you feel real productive, and yet look at it, it's frenetic. And it keeps you from a relationship. Remember, we're in the heart about freedom may destroy community. How about those of you who are obsessed with materialism? Having the greatest clothes, shoes, tools, knickknacks, collectibles. I once met a man in a hospital, and I was talking to someone this morning, and it reminded me of it because this is a man who had been addicted to drugs for I don't know how many years. And yet he was a very spiritual man and had really had spiritual encounters with God. And we talked about what God was doing. And he wouldn't come to church because he didn't have a suit. And I said to him that if you have to wear a suit to church, if that's the only thing that can get you there, I bet you would know that there are some people in that congregation who are wearing suits, not to disparage any of this character here, that probably have more sins than you do. Whereas if someone came in here in jeans, I was saying to Carol today, my preference, if I was in your congregation, I'd be in jeans. I wouldn't get all dressed up, that's not me. Probably wouldn't wear sweats, but I would wear jeans to church. Would that mean that I am not as good as anyone else? Absolutely not. So you need to think about how that affects community. How about relational impediments to community and function? How many of you have to please others? That's please others. That's your role in life. You've got to be seen as the person who serves everyone else. Self-deprecating. I'm not important, you are. How does that keep you from community? How does that affect this church as it does its work of God, as a body of Christ? How about those of you who hold on to the past so tightly, especially losses and grief? There was it's a good side of the book, The Other Side of Suffering by John Yancey, who was the father of John Bonet. And I love this quote. And it's about dealing with grief and loss and sadness.
how we can get addicted to that.
He writes, "It's so important to be aware of becoming accustomed to the dark. The longer we sit crouched in the night of our soul, the more likely we are to accept darkness as our fate. The valley becomes our address, our souls stay solemn and wounded, and we begin to make choices to accommodate our misery." I bet you know people who have just stayed in that sadness. You have major depression, which the brain makes you just focus on that. And what happens when that consumes you? How about those who have trauma and victim identities as opposed to survivor mentalities? How about all those old scripts that influence your self-esteem, telling you you're not good enough, you never will be? How about that longing for the traditional sense of church? That longing for how it used to be, when the pews were filled and this was the center of all social activity in the community's life, as opposed to how it is now and fear of upcoming changes. As we move forward as a church, you need to be aware, saying that we tried that before and it won't work. Well, you may have tried that 10 years ago, or 20 years ago, or even 5 years ago, but you have different sets of people that may make us grow. We have to allow for the Spirit to be working within our church, to be thinking about how we can feed the children, as we talked about earlier, to be thinking about what our mission is, to be getting our folks out there in the parades, to get our message out, to move ourselves beyond who we are. If you hold on to what we were and what we've been, then you're going to be left behind. Or you're going to be seen as an obstructionist, essentially. That I'm trying, you know those people that are pessimistic and negative and every time they come up with a new idea, oh, we can't do that. You need to be careful of that. You need to pray about what God and where God is leading this church, because it will affect our community. It will affect our mission. It will affect how God is seen in this world and who we are. Paul's solution for the Galatians to this self-indulgence is to be called to a life of loving service. He writes, "Through love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment." Well, actually two. "You shall love your Lord with all your heart and mind and strength. And as Jesus said, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." The third potential impediment to freedom is moral relativism. Now, this is kind of hard to understand, but it's why a lot of people don't come to church, because they think when they come here, they're going to get judged for what they wear, for who they love, for what color their skin is, for what socioeconomic status they have, for whether they have a mental illness, or maybe have had a drug addiction. Maybe for how they look, or how they smell. People are afraid to come into church because they're afraid to be judged. That's moral relativism. Because perspective rules the day. We're in the midst of a national debate, and I'm not taking sides here, I'm just kind of throwing it out there, among people who believe that they are based on who they are, what they could value, and what their society and culture and church tells them. Debate about immigration. Debate about abortion. Debate about white nationalism. Debate about gun ownership. You name the issue that people feel passionate about. That's when moral relativism comes into play. Because we're not necessarily listening to God. We're standing on our high ground. And we're not listening to God or to others. Moral conflict is a genuine issue for every one of us. Moral conflict is a genuine issue that you are faced with. Because every one of us wants to feel that we understand what's right and wrong, don't we? Whatever side we're on. And then we don't speak to one another. When you're in doubt, Paul challenges us to be guided by the Spirit. Because all these ideologies stem from freedom, beliefs, and values and culture. And what does it mean to be guided by the Spirit? This is how you'll know. Are you living in love, joy, peace? Are you being patient? Are you being kind and generous? Are you being faithful, gentle, and are you exhibiting self-control? That's the way Paul puts it. It's verse 5 in Galatians 25, I'm sorry, in Galatians 5. More contemporary folks might say, what would Jesus do? You know the WWJD? And that's why church is so important. Because we need a community to kind of back these ideas around. We need to be exposed to scripture that we might not necessarily agree with. Because sometimes it's really hard, even for pastors, to understand the Bible on their own. That's why we need church. That's why church is such an important thing in this world right now. To listen to scripture. To, as a group, to begin to tussle with some of these ideas so that you're not all right and you're not all wrong. So that we can have some way of opening ourselves and welcoming people of different values, different faiths, different traditions, different experiences, and listen. Paul's letter to the Galatians is an incredibly important one. In Luke, disciples are asking Jesus, how can we follow him? Paul writes that down for them. Live in love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Because that's